Good evening and welcome Leo Panitch and Sam Gindin. On my left side, from my point of view, is Sam Gindin. For many years, he was a research director at the Canadian Auto Workers, and I think he played an important role in working out the strategy of the Canadian trade union movement, also in relation to the United States, the more powerful neighbor. And he was frequently invited to Germany when it comes to discussing an alternative to the corporatist strategy of trade unions here in Germany or in Europe. Within the left in the trade unions, he was often invited to discuss these issues. He retired from the Canadian Auto Workers, and he is now a Pecker. He holds now the Pecker Chair in Social Justice at the Department of Political Science at the York University in Toronto. In the center is Leo Panitch. He is also professor of political science at the Department of Political Science at the York University in Toronto. He is a distinguished research professor in comparative political economy, and he is also editor of the Socialist Register. Many of you will know it, I think. It is one of the most important periodicals, I would say, in the whole world from a left point of view. An annual volume. I have here the volume of last year, The Crisis and the Left. Leo also brought the current volume, The Question of Strategy. I think maybe he can say more about the new issue. You can easily buy it also from VSA Verlag. It is available here in Germany as well. It is published now in many countries around the world. So both of you, we are very happy to have you here. It is a great honor for us, I think. And I think both are a good example how important a close friendship can be over the decades, like with Marx and Engels or with Horkheimer and Adorno. You work together for many years, and this collaboration has been very fruitful. Now this book appeared, The Making of Global Capitalism, The Political Economy of the American Empire. And this is also the topic this evening. I think this book has been long in the making. I also had the chance to follow this process because I had the chance to work together with Leo and Sam at York University in 2005 and 2006 in this project on production, finance, and American empire. And several works have appeared over the years which are related to this research project. One of the contributions has also appeared in German translation. I think Globaler Kapitalismus und Amerikanisches Empire, also in VSA Verlag in 2004, related to the new debate on imperialism, which started after the war in Iraq, or maybe which started some years earlier with Hart and Negri's empire. I think after we had in the 1980s and 1990s less and less interest in the debate on imperialism, there was a restart of this debate, the debate around about the new imperialism after September 11, the wars in Afghanistan and then Iraq. And also Leo and Sam made important contributions in this debate. And now the new book, I think, is the culmination of this debate, the final product, I think, of this long research project. I do not want to make a longer introduction. I think they can tell more and more precisely about their own work. So again, welcome to have you here. We said that they will talk about 45 minutes, and then we will have a discussion afterwards. And then you are also invited to share some drinks here. We also have some copies of the book over there. You can buy them for 20 euros if you like, after the discussion. And I also would like to remind you that you should sign in a list your names and addresses, as with any discussion we have here in Rosa Luxemburg Foundation. We need this to document our activities because we get the money from the state and so on. Okay, so I don't know who is going to start first. Leo.
Thank you very, very much, Thomas. It's a great pleasure to be here. Michael Brie issued the invitation for us to come when I met him in August in Denver, Colorado, at a sociology conference. I'm especially pleased that it's Thomas who is introducing us. We met Thomas 10 years ago at the time when we gave another talk, a previous talk, exactly 10 years ago in October 2002 to the Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung in this building. And it was that very week that for the first time we met Thomas. We were asking for someone who understood the car industry in Germany. And everyone we spoke to said, the person you need to speak to is Thomas Zablowski. And we learned a great deal from him, so much that I was able to invite him to come to York University for a year, teach in our political science department, and the three of us actually shared an office. It was a wonderful experience, and I'm very happy to see, and I think the Stiftung is very wise to see that Thomas is now here. When we were invited by the Stiftung 10 years ago, first of all, I want to say it was a very different audience, very different. It was in, also in this building, in a long, narrow seminar room. There were more people there, I have to say, but they were distinctly very much older than the people in this room for the most part, which is very interesting, and almost universally male, which in contrast with who's here tonight is also very interesting. We came for two reasons. We were invited by Frank Deppa to a conference in Marburg, and Rainer Rilling knew we were invited to that, so he invited us also to come to Berlin. And we had already just begun working on this book. This book on the making of global capitalism has been a very long time in the making, over 10 years. And in fact, as Thomas says, you could say it's really 50 years, because Sam and I met exactly 50 years ago in the fall of 1962 in a Latin class at the University of Manitoba, in first year university. It was to Sam that I first whispered, probably a year later, I think I'm a Marxist. We had written a critique of Hartin Negri's Empire, which was a clearing of the ground, in a sense, for the work we were doing. But the origins of the main thesis of the book and our work in this area long precede Hartin Negri's Empire. During the campaign against NAFTA, Sam, as the chief economist in the Canadian Auto Workers Union, which had broken away from the international union over the question of concessions to Chrysler when it was threatened with bankruptcy in 1979, came to the fore, and the American Congress insisted that the workers reopen the union, reopen the contract, and give various concessions to gains that had been made in the collective agreement. The Canadian Union broke away, partly saying, using nationalist reasons, we are in a different nation state, and the US Congress can't tell us what to do as Canadian citizens. And it was a successful split, and they in fact defeated General Motors in a strike a few years later. It, for a period, was a very militant, politically as well as economically militant union, and in the campaign against the North American Free Trade Agreement, Sam and a comrade of his produced a pamphlet, the central theme of which was that competition is a constraint for workers, a constraint for trade unions, but it's not our goal. And the problem with globalization, it argued, was that competition, competitiveness, was becoming the goal of the trade union movement itself. A year later, I wrote an article that acquired some notoriety called Globalization and the State, in which I addressed the very fashionable claim, which Hart and Negri themselves took up almost a decade later, that the process of globalization, the transnationalization of markets, the movement of capital around the world, was a matter of bypassing states, was a matter of escaping state regulation, was a matter of diminishing state power. And I argued that, on the contrary, globalization was, if anything, authored by states. It wasn't multinational corporations that signed free trade agreements. It was states that signed free trade agreements. And in order to make transnational capitalism work, you needed very active states in protecting property, creating new rules for markets, especially financial markets, and codifying them, overseeing them, facilitating, in a way that you know very well, the process of European monetary union has involved in Europe, has involved extremely active state actors in the making of transnational markets. But of course, there are states and states. As we Canadians know better than anybody, the Canadian state is not the American state. And as the Greeks have discovered in this crisis, the Greek state is not the German state. Much influenced by the great Greek-French Marxist theorist of the state, Nikos Poulantzas, who I didn't like much when I was a student in the 1970s. I was on the Miliband side of that very famous Miliband-Poulantzas debate. I thought, and I'd written an essay in New Left Review called The New Imperial State in 2000, a year or two before Hart Negri's Empire came up, trying to get a handle on the nature of this unique American empire. And I used Poulantzas, who had the insight already in the early 1970s, which we Canadians have always understood very well, that when capital crosses a border, it doesn't just cross as money, as investment. It crosses as a class force. And that he argued that the entry of American multinational corporations into Europe meant that American capital had emplaced itself as a class force on the terrain of the European capitalist state. And insofar as he defined the state as a field of class representation, class compromise, class struggle. That's how he defined the state, right? He saw American capital as a very significant and powerful class force inside the European state. And he argued from that basis that this was disarticulating the national bourgeoisies of Europe. He was engaging in a debate with Ernest Mandel, who argued that the recovery of Europe, and especially Germany, by the 1960s, meant that we were seeing a reintroduction of inter-imperial rivalry, competitiveness between the countries of the capitalist core. He understood much better than Mandel that the European bourgeoisie in the 1970s crisis, as Poulantzas put it, was not challenging American hegemony. It was a crisis in which all of the bourgeoisies of the advanced capitalist world were all equally involved, and all that was happening was that they were renegotiating their position within American hegemony rather than challenging. One of the opportunities that coming here allowed for me and Sam 10 years ago to speak at the Stiftung was not so much to do this critique of Hart Negri, which we had already written. It was very easy. Their notion also that capital itself was the empire and had bypassed states, although they were inconsistent in the book in many places in this respect. It was that it gave us an opportunity to really do some research. One of the reasons we wanted to talk to people who understood the German auto industry, like Thomas, was to get a sense whether Ford and General Motors were very powerful class forces on the terrain of the German state. And that was one of the questions we were asking. And universally, we were told, including by Thomas, who studied and understood Ford in Europe very, very well, that no, their degree of influence inside the German state was much less than Daimler and Volkswagen. The significance of American capital in Europe was rather that, in a sense, the most European corporations, in terms of integrated production across borders, were the American corporations at that time. They were more European in the sense of being transnational within Europe, in the sense of having integrated production, than were the national auto companies at that time, although the others were moving very quickly in that direction. And I began to understand, and I'd always sensed it, and even said it in that original article in New Left Review in 2000, that the trouble with the Poulenzasian understanding of the capitalist state was precisely that it defined the state in terms of class relations, class compromises, class struggle, which of course is not incorrect. But it failed to capture the institutional autonomy and specificity of capitalist states. And let me elaborate on what this means and how also that visit and the research we did at that time helped us understand this. I was already uncomfortable with the fact that Poulenzas never explained why multinational corporations grew to such a, came to Europe to such an enormous extent only in the 1960s and not in 1945. Of course, Ford and General Motors had come in the 1920s, but had been interrupted by the breakdown of globalization in the Great Depression and the Second World War. But American multinationals did not Europe right away after 1945. What was significant about what happened after 1945 was precisely the linkages that were created between the states of Europe, the capitalist states of Europe, and the American state. The linkages, of course, at the level of NATO, at the level of the security apparatuses, etc., but also the linkages created amongst the economic institutions of the American state and the European states. After the Second World War, which was very much a matter of empire by invitation on the part of the ruling classes of Western Europe. It wasn't simply a matter of military presence by any means. The American state was invited to play that role in rebuilding the capitalist states of Europe. It involved the American state helping to create the conditions, not only through the Marshall Plan, but also through the productivity councils that were established here by American trade unions. The encouragement of the type of welfare states that didn't exist in the United States, given a different balance of class forces, but which the Americans were quite prepared to be seen to develop in Europe. All of that was the condition where the basis was finally laid for the American multinationals' interest in the enormous foreign direct investment that flowed into Europe by the late 1950s, early 1960s. In a sense, the reason that American capital always came to Canada in a different way than it went to Latin America, not primarily in search of raw materials, not primarily in search of resources, but in order to sell to a rich proletariat, in order to sell to farmers who were well off, was the reason that American multinationals came to Europe by the 1960s, to capture this large, wealthy market of a high-wage proletariat, which the American state had helped to create the conditions for in the post-war period, including by allowing for 15 years there to be capital controls in Europe, which including exchange controls on currency, which Wall Street had been very opposed to, because they wanted whatever capital to get out of Europe to flow to Wall Street. And the American state, with Bretton Woods, prevented this, allowed these capital controls. And it was only with the establishment of a certain floor below which European workers would not fall. It was only with the establishment of the beginnings of full employment in Europe, especially here in Germany by the 1960s, the creation of this large and wealthy market that American multinationals came. So, this then points to the importance of the state, not just of capital, in the integration of the capitalist core. And a second dimension of this, which was also confirmed by our coming here at the time, was that just before we came, Daimler had bought Chrysler. And a great many people, on the right, on the left, were discussing this in terms of German imperialism, especially in the United States. We actually interviewed Dieter Zetsche, who was the head of Daimler in the United States, in Detroit. And half of his interview with us was a matter of saying, we're an American corporation, we're not a German corporation, because the Republicans in Congress weren't very happy about Germans taking over this American firm. But the interviews we did with him, the interviews we did with Daimler executives in Stuttgart, made it very clear to us that they did not at all see this as a matter of German capital taking over, challenging American capital. On the contrary, and I think it's worth reading a passage here in this respect from the interviews we did exactly 10 years ago when we were here at Daimler. This is based on our interviews. The Daimler takeover of Chrysler, they told us, was motivated by the Daimler executives' prior decision, I'm quoting them, to concentrate on auto rather than diversification, and a determination to survive as one of the five or six world auto companies. This was widely seen as evidence of U.S. decline. Yet the Daimler executives themselves explicitly saw it in terms of embracing American spirit, attitude, and drive. That was their words when we interviewed them. As well as flexible production methods, venture capital markets, broad distribution networks, and lower taxes. Since Daimler CEO Jürgen Schramm had already famously taken on board the American management values of the 1990s, writing all kinds of pieces about shareholder value and how wonderful they were, by the time Daimler-Benz, whose main shareholder, of course, was the Deutsche Bank, acquired Chrysler in 1998, this confirmed the survival of the German industrial muscle, but it was the very reverse of European over American managerialism. It was American managerialism that was driving, in many senses, the Daimler interest in entering the American market in this way. So Schramm's popularization of shareholder value was explained by his successors, Detscher, who was then head of the American branch, as being, as he told us, one of the mechanisms for putting pressure on Daimler managers and workers to stay competitive, while its short-termist drawbacks of shareholder value were seen as inevitable in light of the fact, as he told us, that the American system is now more or less the worldwide system. We interviewed at the same time workers, including the chief of the head of the Works Council at Daimler, Clem. And he presaged for us at that time what was to become, of course, well known through the course of this decade, which was the cooperation of Daimler workers, including the very powerful stewards involved in the Works Councils, in the labor flexibilization, in the wage restraint, which would make German exports so central to the dynamism of the first half of the first decade of the 21st century, and which would lay the basis for the enormous imbalance between German exports in Europe and German imports, and German, indeed, the growth of German wages and demand, which were so restrained through the course of this decade and are so much a source of why the current crisis is so deep in Europe. Finally, and this is very much about the importance of the state, which Poulantzas, I think, didn't get, and most Marxists haven't understood about the nature of American empire. We interviewed a number of senior figures in the Bundesbank. Now, you know very well that the Bundesbank, the people who run the Bundesbank, are not shrinking violets. They have big egos. They're not modest. And what was so very interesting about talking to them, and I could quote again, but it'll take too long probably, was the way in which they insisted that, and this is in the wake, remember, of 2001, of 9/11, the wake of the Asian crisis, all of this talk about American decline, etc. They insisted that nothing happened in terms of the making of international monetary policy and the active role of central banks in the world, nothing happens unless the Americans make it happen. As one of them put it to us, quoting Keynes, we often propose, but only they dispose. Yes. Which was interesting coming from these big egos. But more important was how they described to us how, when 9/11 happened, what was activated were the telephone numbers that they had been exchanging from with one another ever since the Herstatt Bank crisis of 1974, when the Bundesbank, which has always read Hayek more than Keynes, even was doing it in the 1940s, was reading Hayek more than Keynes, and has been the most reluctant of central banks in the advanced capitalist core to bail out banks when there's a financial crisis, operates on the neoclassical principle, well, they ought to go under and there will be equilibrium in the markets eventually, never mind the mess that is made in the meantime. It has been the US Treasury and the Federal Reserve that has had to drag the Bundesbank into playing a role, a responsible role, as far as capitalists are concerned, capitalist states are concerned, in managing the crises of contemporary capitalism, especially the financial crises of financial capitalism. We've seen it in this crisis again, but you could see it at every moment of significant crisis when the American Treasury and Federal Reserve, who are burdened with the responsibility of trying to contain these crises, not only at home but internationally, try to get cooperation from the German Bundesbank. They have always been most reluctant to do so. This was true in all of the 72 financial crises in low and middle income countries in the 1990s, as they removed capital controls and entered into global capitalism. It was most visibly true during the famous Mexico peso crisis of 1994. It was true again in the Asian crisis of 1997-98. Inevitably, in each case, the Bundesbank eventually gets around to playing a certain role. and that's even happening now under tremendous American concern and pressure about the ECBs and the, because of the Bundesbank's position, the Bundesbank itself, a lack of responsibility in undertaking the kind of monetary policy liquidity provision to the banking system and even to the sovereign states of Europe in their debt crisis, that the American state would like them to play, not to solve this crisis, but in order to keep stumbling through it without a disaster. Now there you get to some of the understanding we need to have of what we mean by empire. Most people think when we speak of empire that we're talking about the projection of American national interests, whatever those are, however they're arrived at, on other states. And always, of course, there's an element of that. But our main understanding of the sense in which the American state is a unique empire in the last half of the 20th century and continues to be into this century and right through this crisis is that for reasons that are historically contingent, it got burdened with the responsibility of acting not only for its capital, but acting for world capital, for taking responsibility for reproducing in the post-war period the capitalist classes of Germany, the rest of Europe and Japan, the capitalist states, and continuing to take responsibility for managing, extending and managing a global capitalist system and protecting property within it more than any other state does. That often causes conflicts with its own inside the United States because it remains a state of its own social formation. So there are frictions with all kinds of elements inside the United States who feel they are burdened by the making of global capitalism. To some extent they are. But in every case, the overarching American role in the world trumps those domestic interests. They never seem to prevent the reproduction and continuation of that role. Okay, so that trip 10 years ago was very useful and important to us. We used it, in fact, as a basis to also drop in on the British Treasury and interview senior people there. And we were told that by very senior people in the UK Treasury that they spend more time talking to their counterparts on a weekly basis in Washington than they do to other members of the UK Treasury across the corridor from them in Washington. And what we have failed, I think, to understand is the extent to which there is not a transnational state. You know, this stupid notion that because capital goes transnational, you have to have a transnational state, which is very common amongst the sociologists of globalization. No, nation states remain irreducible, as you indeed see, even in Europe, where you have a regional apparatus that is the constitutionally most extensive by far of any international institution in the world. But you see the irreducibility of nation states within it, which is another question we asked Thomas and other people 10 years ago. You especially see it now. It's not that nation states go away. It's that amongst the key capitalist states, there has been, especially since the dollar crisis of the 1960s, there has been a very close integration and accommodation of key personnel and staff of the financial agencies of the capitalist states. And in this crisis, what is most remarkable, as was also true in the crisis of the 70s, but it's happening again now and more interestingly in a way, is that just as the crisis of the 70s did not produce inter-imperial rivalry, did not produce the kinds of conflicts between the states that broke down the tendency to global capitalism that had already been going on since 1945, but accelerated it after the way that crisis was resolved in the 80s and 90s. In this crisis, you now see, not only amongst the G7 states, but amongst the G20 states, that is, among the big developing capitalist states of the global south, a similar type of cooperation and accommodation. The G20 was created by the G7, by these finance ministers and central banks of the G7, after the Asian crisis, to attempt to create a new financial architecture that would stabilize finance after the Asian crisis. The creation of bankruptcy laws in third world states, judicial systems that would facilitate the flow of capital into them in a stable way. It wasn't until the crisis of 2007, which exploded much greater way in 2008, although the Federal Reserve had already been lending as much or more to European banks than it had been lending to American banks in order to stem the crisis, because they were so heavily invested, including your Landesbanken, were so heavily invested in American mortgage-backed securities. And immediately, the biggest banks that went to the U.S. Federal Reserve in 2007 were the Bank of China and European banks for the American dollars they needed to keep them solvent. The Federal Reserve didn't talk about that much because it's not very popular at home to be lending to foreign banks, but that's its responsibility, it's its role. Well, in 2008, George Bush invited the leaders of the G20 countries to Washington. They had never met before. Only finance officials, central bank officials had met. And they pledged themselves in Washington in the fall of 2008 that whatever domestic policies they undertook to cope with this new great crisis, the fourth great crisis of capitalism, which they all recognized was of that order, that whatever domestic policies they undertook would not have the effect, they would not be the type of policies which would interrupt the continuing process of globalization. They would not be introducing tariffs. They would not be introducing the types of capital controls that would interrupt capital flows, very differently than what began to happen between 1873 and 1896, and very differently, of course, from what happened in the 1930s. And what's remarkable is the extent to which they have kept that commitment. They met again in June 2010 in Toronto. Many of you will remember the police riot that attended that G20 meeting in Toronto. And they said, we'd made that commitment in 2008, and we are happy to renew it again. And they have. Okay. Now, that's quite remarkable, given that we're now not talking about Europe and North America. It's one thing, as Raymond Aron and Poulantzas were doing in the late 60s, early 70s, to talk of the Canadianization of Europe. After all, there's a degree of common history, common culture, common religions, even a certain common languages, etc. But the degree of cooperation we're now finding amongst the global, rapidly developing capitalist states of the South and the American state apparatus is very interesting. And in some ways, even surprising. How long it will last is difficult to see. But it's very significant that in this crisis, we are not seeing, despite the fact that we have China, Brazil, India, now so heavily engaged in a global capitalism, we are not seeing the development of conflict between states. What we see is massive conflict within states. Not so much in this country, unfortunately. But we see the strike waves in China. We see the occupation of public squares around the world, above all Syntagma in Greece, and what that represents in terms of the likelihood of a very radical socialist party getting elected within the year, Syriza. And we do not see, in terms of that conflict within states, conflict between industrial and financial capital. Capital remains relatively united in this crisis. We see the extent to which, even though the crisis began in finance, industry understands how functional finance is to integrated production around the world. So the big question then becomes, as it really should have been for the 1970s, What form will this conflict within states take? Will it take the kind of form that will be oriented to finding Keynesian solutions to this crisis? Extending European integration so that you have more fiscal discipline through a common fiscal policy? To my astonishment, I just read today a quotation by Jürgen Habermas in August 2012, which called for explicitly for that. We need a common fiscal policy so that we can have discipline, fiscal discipline on states, right? Which means social discipline, of course, right? It's the discipline of the bankers. Yes. Will that be the solution that we'll be moved to? Or will there be what even the DGB called for in the 1970s? Structure politik, investment planning. Will there be the type of alternative economic strategy that is oriented to turning the banks into public utilities? Right. Which is oriented to democratizing states, and through democratizing states, democratizing the economy. And I just want to end with that last point and two comments in relation to it. You know, I've been, long before this crisis, calling for the central platform insofar as there's a policy platform we need. Above all, we need organization on the left, of course. But insofar as there's a policy platform we need, it ought to be a policy platform around the importance of turning the financial system into a democratic public utility. That's the condition of everything else. It's the condition of dealing with the environmental, at least the climate crisis. Because if we're going to have conversion of industry into ecologically sustainable production, we need to be able to plan where investment goes more than ever. Ironically, the irrationality of our system is that the left-wing solution, the progressive solution, to solving the climate crisis is to use financial derivatives markets for carbon trading. That's the progressive solution that we now have, rather than democratic economic planning, which has to begin with taking the banks into the public sector. And I want to pay a compliment to Die Linke. Because I've been looking for a long time at who is writing about, in a serious, sober, detailed way, what it would mean to turn a financial system into a democratic public utility. And I organized a panel on this in New York in March. And the research assistant to the Die Linke spokesman on finance in the Bundestag came and presented a paper. A very detailed 60-page paper on how you would turn the German banking system into a democratic public utility. And it's by far the richest, most sober, most detailed document of this kind that I think exists in the world. The importance of this relates to the situation you now face in Europe. Because, in a sense, we're back to 1917. If the Greeks elect Syriza, who want to stay in the Eurozone and want to stay in the EU, very much, but they will definitely, if they're elected, they will have to reject the legislation that implements the memoranda of the Troika. They think that the powers that be will back down rather than have Greece leave. But if they don't, and they have to leave the Eurozone and even the EU, although legally, it's constitutionally, it's very difficult to see how you make somebody leave. This would be a nightmare constitutionally. But if they did, right, we should not think, as some Greek economists have been arguing, that getting out of the euro, being able to devalue their currency, would make it easy for the Greek people. They would then still have to import oil and energy. They'd have to be buying the German intermediate goods, especially since their manufacturing industry has decimated itself since it joined the European Union, that are needed to keep their productive sphere going at all. And unless there's a shift in the balance of forces in Northern Europe, above all in this country, the Greek people, if they're pushed out of the euro, will suffer even more enormously than they are now suffering. And why I say we're back to 1917 is you'll remember the notion that Russia was the weakest link, and the expectation that it could possibly succeed depended on a shift in the balance of forces in Germany. We're not in that situation. Greece is not Russia, etc., etc. But there are similar tones here. And I assure you that the American state agents of the Federal Reserve and the U.S. Treasury, who spend an enormous amount of time on the phone, not only with the ECB, but with the Bundesbank, constantly, weekly, maybe daily, right, are most concerned that the Eurozone crisis will lead to the reintroduction by some European states of extensive capital and exchange controls, and will begin unraveling the process of the making of global capitalism. It's our job to try to do that. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to try to address the question of the American empire actually beginning at home, in the sense that the reproduction of empire rests on recreating the material base of American capital, and it rests on containing the social forces that might inhibit the restructuring of capital as part of the process of the making of global capital. So in a sense, what I'm addressing is the question, two questions, the issue of American declinism and the issue of the crisis of trade unions in the US, which affects in some way unions everywhere, but also, I think, applies to unions more generally. So let me start with this question of the material base of the American empire. After Europe and Japan recovered, when you looked at the situation in the early 70s, people pointed to the fact that after the war, the US had about 50% of industrial production globally, and by the early 70s, it had less than a half of that. It was down to about 23%. And this was used as an example of a weakening of the American empire. It had that smaller share. But in fact, it was a measure of the success of the American empire. Because if we're thinking in imperial terms, the critical point about the making of global capitalism was that was the spread of capitalism, that the US was making capitalism in other countries. And for American capital, it had a smaller share, but this was a smaller share with remarkably greater opportunities because of the expansion of capitalism and the extent of that expansion in Europe and Japan. And it also meant that that process of the spreading of capitalism was also integrating through different stages, integrating European and Japanese capitalism, capital into the American empire. In the 70s, there was a crisis in American capital, and there was a crisis. It was a crisis of productivity slowing down. It was a crisis of profits. It was a crisis of inflation rising as workers tried to maintain their expectations as the post-war boom slowed down. And because of the crisis of inflation, it was also a crisis of the American dollar. And the question is, what happened? And what happened, there's nothing inevitable about America coming out of this reproducing its material strength. It was contingent. And when people look at this, one of the things that people look at especially has been the trade deficit as a measure of American weakness. Since from the late 70s virtually through to today, almost every year there's been a trade deficit. And one of the problems with looking at that kind of a measure is that it's looking at national statistics when we're looking at a global economy. Once we acknowledge that multinational corporations have been so central to the way global capitalism is organized, the point is that American multinationals produce about four times as much abroad as is exported from the United States. So the fact that just looking at exports doesn't tell you the story. Second of all, when you actually look at the trade deficit, The fact is that American exports have been rising very fast. They've been growing about 6.5% a year over that quarter decade after 1983, almost as fast as Germany and China, and faster than every other country. The reason for the deficit is because they've also been able to import. And if this was any other country, importing more than exporting over such a sustained period would be blocked. You couldn't do it. The U.S. is the only country that can really do that over that kind of a period because of the American dollar and because of the inflow of capital, which isn't just coming in to offset imports. It's coming in for independent reasons of either wanting the safety of the U.S. dollar, wanting treasuries, or wanting to invest in the United States. Like Daimler. So what it really means is, rather than a weakness, what it shows is the ability of the U.S. to disproportionately get access to the value produced by labor internationally. Another measure of the weakness of American capital has been the growth of finance, and that's been seen as a symptom of decline. And as Leo emphasized, the point about finance is that it's both functional and dysfunctional. It's very volatile, but it serves an essential role. In the same way that as you get a global economy, the role of transportation explodes, the role of warehouses explodes, you have the same thing with financial services. You can't have a global economy without the kind of deep financial markets that can provide the service of dealing with risk so that companies can not restrain themselves because they're so worried about the risk, but actually take on the risks that are involved in dealing with all the risks that globalization involves, especially, of course, the risk of exchange rates. And in addition to that, finance has been so functional in terms of the restructuring that goes on in the U.S. economy, in terms of mergers, in terms of venture capital. It hasn't been as important in just straight credit because profits have actually been high, and finance has played a very important role in the U.S. just in terms of reallocating capital and playing the role of abstract capital to discipline capital. And therefore, it may not be producing the surplus value itself, but it's pressuring capital to constantly produce more surplus value, to become more efficient, and reallocating capital to where it's most efficient. So what's been going on in the United States, which is often described as hollowing out, which has some accuracy when you're talking about workers, it has no accuracy when you're actually talking about what's happening to capital. The proper description of what was happening in the U.S. in that quarter of a century, from the early 80s on, was restructuring. The introduction of new technology, the restructuring of workplaces in terms of managerial authority, the outsourcing of work and the reorganization of production chains, the relocation of production as some plants closed, others were opening up, whether it was in rural areas or in the American South. So when the what you see as you look at that period through the crisis is that, in fact, U.S. productivity grows very fast compared to other countries. Manufacturing productivity in this period is actually growing faster than it did in the earlier golden age. The profit decline ends and profits start increasing. Inflation is broken, not just in the Volcker period for a short period of time through an economic crisis. It's broken permanently. Inflation becomes a parameter in the economy of low inflation, and the dollar is in fact strengthened. So when we turn to thinking about crises in this new period, the way we have to think about it is not as a continuation of a crisis that's been going on through the 70s, but that the crisis of the 70s was resolved, that any new crisis is coming out of the contradictions that are emerging out of the resolution of that earlier crisis. It's a different kind of a crisis. Okay, let me turn from there now. I should say, I'm sorry, I left this out. I wanted to just give this set of facts. When we look at American multinationals, what is so striking, when you're not looking at the trade deficits, but you're actually looking at multinational corporations, when you look at the top three or four companies in this set of industries, they're all American. Technological hardware and equipment, software and computers, aerospace and military, oil equipment. When you look at global media, four of the five top companies are U.S. When you look at pharma care, industrial transportation, industrial equipment, and fixed line telecoms, two out of the three top corporations in the world are American. Retail, five of the top six are American. Healthcare, 14 of the top 16 are American, which is so important because of the growth of the healthcare sector for demographic and other reasons. And nine out of the 10 corporations in terms of global financial services are American. So what you see is that the commanding heights of the economy, of the international economy, in terms of manufacturing, high-tech manufacturing, and in terms of the crucial business services, that anybody who's trying to emulate the United States or compete with it looks to, that in terms of engineering, in terms of consultancy, in terms of legal, accounting, and of course finance, those firms are overwhelmingly American firms, much more overwhelming than even the position of the United States in manufacturing at the end of the war. Okay, I want to turn from there to this question of containing the social forces and especially the working class if the empire is going to be reproduced. So in 1945, right after the war, the crucial question was how to channel the militancy of the working class in a way that was essentially safe for the making of global capitalism. It was how to channel it away from class conflict into an emphasis on growth, into productivism, which meant that workers would see themselves as essentially selling their labor power and getting the power to consume in exchange for that, individual consumption in exchange for that, rather than seeing themselves in terms of challenging the democracy of the workplace, control over investment, and any say in what is actually produced. And as Leah was saying, that was actually also exported to the United States through setting up productivity councils in Europe, but especially through inviting European trade unionists into the United States to see how the advantages of cooperating with management to get the growth and then trying to share in that growth, what you're essentially doing at a time when Europe was suffering from the stagnation in consumption through those difficult periods, they were seeing what American consumerism could mean. So they weren't just taken to factories to see what was happening in terms of cooperation, they were taken to shopping centers. The American dream was essentially exported to Europe. When you come to the 70s, what you find is that even though that thrust towards challenging capital, that thrust from the left was defeated, the fact of full employment still meant that the militancy of workers was affecting American capital's ability to improve productivity and to maintain its profits. And that militancy was also expressed through the emergence of a new left that was beginning to raise broader questions. The problem for workers was that they never developed the capacity to actually move beyond that militancy, to actually challenge in a much larger way capital. And I think it's a very important question for where we're at today. It was about the limits of that militancy as opposed to reaching the point where we could actually start thinking about control over prices directly, control over the flow of investment so you weren't just having to respond to the threat of capital leaving. And the result of not being able to do that meant that workers were basically worn down over that decade. It took a long time to solve that crisis, but through that crisis, without workers being able to come up with their own solution, eventually workers began to react to the question of, well, how do we solve the unemployment question? How do we deal with the inflation that's eroding our lives? And they were weakened by it. And that's the context in which neoliberalism emerges. Now, the ways that neoliberalism weakened the working class was fundamentally through the unemployment, which restored a degree of insecurity. But the restructuring of industry itself weakened the working class in a number of ways. And it's not so much that this was planned, it was just a consequence of the kind of restructuring that took place. One is that there was this radical shift away from unionized jobs in manufacturing. In the early 80s, there were 7.5 million workers in unionized manufacturing jobs, 7.5 million. If you just project that to the end of the 90s, that should have been 11 million if you just projected by the growth in the labor force. It was 1.5 million by the end of the 90s. So you've got, you know, something like an 85% decrease. So you're obviously undermining the fundamental basis of union strength. In terms of investment, there's a radical shift to investment in equipment. The rate of investment in the US is very high when you do it in real terms, but there's a radical shift in equipment which is linked to the technological changes. So whereas from 50 to 82, the growth, the increase in prices of investment goods was something like 4% a year. When you look at the increase in investment goods from 1983 to the end of the 90s, in fact into 2007, it was actually less than 4% for the whole period. Not just per year, but for the whole period. And so there's very high investment, but it's in equipment, it's not in structures. And that begins to affect jobs, particularly. It's not that kind of expansion, but it's equipment, which is also leading to job dislocation. And the restructuring is affecting the formation of classes through, in the earlier periods of stable employment in communities, you had the development of a certain kind of class consciousness and class institutions over a number of generations. They might not have been socialists, but there was a certain sense of class consciousness. With this restructuring, even if the macro jobs involves plants closing here and moving someplace else, industry growing someplace else, service jobs growing someplace else, you were destroying communities. And rather than any kind of class consciousness spreading, that destroyed class consciousness where it was. So what happens with neoliberalism is that there are structural tendencies in capitalism which always tend to weaken the working class, even as it is resisting. There's the question of the pressures on the working class to think in immediate terms. There's the fact that the working class is always fragmented based on the workplace. And there's the fact that the working class is dependent on capital for its job. It's dependent on capital in the sense of seeing that what happens on a daily basis is that workers don't have the power to organize production. They sell the labor to somebody that does. And what neoliberalism did, in a sense, through what was evolving, was it built on those weaknesses. What competitiveness did is it strengthened the link, the dependence on their own corporation, and broke up any the potential for solidarity. What it did was that it increased the pressures on workers to survive. And in the context of a defeat of the left, in the context of an absence of collective mechanisms for struggle, people tried to survive as individuals. They increased their hours of work, the hours of work of women in particular in the household, increased in the United States through until the late 90s, through the 80s and into the late 90s. It was a process that began before neoliberalism, but you could really see the extent to which it was growing in that period. People looked to increases in pension funds in the stock market to improve their pensions. They looked to their homes as an asset that they could borrow on or that could be something that would give them their savings. And of course, they generally went into debt. Now the point about that kind of individual survival and that kind of competitiveness is that it led to an atrophy of collective sensibilities and collective capacities as people were not on the street in struggle or not struggling on picket lines, but instead hoping that maybe they'll get a wage increase through a tax cut, as an example. So it very much began to shape the formation of the working class in a particular way. Now, a lot of this was also exported to Europe, and not in some mechanical way, because the neoliberalism in the US, it became a parameter for Europe. It increased pressures on Europe to do the same, especially as capital was successful. And it took a while for that to emerge in Europe. You don't see much of that happening through the 80s. You only begin to really see that in the 90s, and the same kind of pressure on Europe, and including European integration as being a space in which Europe, through integration, could become more competitive. Okay. Let me draw some conclusions from all of this. One is that there are contradictions in this process that are important. First of all, obviously, there was a lot of delegitimation of capitalism in this period, in the sense that, you know, people don't run around talking about how wonderful capitalism is. There's also, there was the contradiction of the private welfare state in the United States. A lot of the solutions that organized workers looked to was how to develop an internal welfare state where the companies would pay them the wages and benefits, and that worked as long as the companies were relatively stable. Once the competition intensifies and the possibility of companies like General Motors or Caterpillar, their remaining viable becomes an issue, then the private welfare state begins to break down. There's the contradiction of the incredible inequality that emerges through all of this, and the question of macro stability. And even when there's macro stability, because finance, people are consuming through finance, there's the contradiction of the fragility of the household financial base, that by borrowing more and depending on a housing bubble when their incomes aren't rising, there's the question of potential fragility there. But there's also contradictions for the working class that are crucial. And in addition to everything that I've raised, one of the crucial contradictions was always there, and I think it is absolutely vital that this is what needs to be dealt with. And that is that unions were always sectional organizations. What unions are unions that represent a specific group of workers that come together because of the workplace. They have some common interests. They may not even have political interests, but they're representing a specific group of workers. And at a, they're not representing the class. They come out of the class, but they aren't class organizations. And in the 50s and 60s in the US, it was possible to make gains in the context of a favorable economic climate in that context. And those gains were even spread to other workers. That's no longer possible today. And that's one of the issues that the working class really has to deal with. The question of if unions are going to be revived, not made into revolutionary organizations, but even made into effective defensive organizations, this question of class is going to have to be addressed, and maybe we can talk a little bit about that, what that might concretely mean in the question period. The second point is that we still see sporadic resistance. You know, in spite of everything, in spite of all the pressures, there is still sporadic resistance. But the problem is that the sporadic resistance just comes and goes. It happens in one place, and then it leaves. It happens someplace else. It doesn't add up to anything else. And for that to add up to anything else, you need some sense of organization that can build on it. Otherwise, it's just a question of containing it in much of the same way that crises in finance are contained. The other point is that in spite of the delegitimacy of capitalism, what's really replaced the notion of buying off workers is fatalism. The sense that we may not like what's going on, it may be lousy, but what can you do about it? And that is enormously powerful, and it can't be overcome unless those moments of resistance are actually built into something, because otherwise you just return to fatalism. There's an explosion and then you kind of return to ordinary life. Or more generally, the question of mobilizing people requires them to see structures through which they can fight, and that'll be meaningful. That doesn't always mean that they can win, but that there are structures through which they can resist, and they have a sense that when they're doing that, it builds something. And I want to emphasize, when I'm talking about organization, I'm not just talking about what we need is new coalitions of movements and what exists today. The problem is that what exists today isn't good enough, even if you add it up. And I include the movements when I talk about that, not just the trade union movement. That we need what we need is a new layer of politics, one that is class-based. It isn't just about the unions, it's about the class broadly defined, the unemployed, the poor, the non-union. It's about the community, but not just about let's link up with other people in the community. It's about recognizing that workers' lives, that class isn't just expressed at the point of production, as important as that is. That workers' lives have all these dimensions, and we have to address the question of the community needs. And it means that we're actually prepared to challenge the logic of capital. If we're not prepared to challenge property relations, if we're taking things as the structure of capital is given and are just looking to some stimulus, or aren't ready to take on what Leo raised in terms of the question of banks, then we can't do it. And any kind of new organization has to address the problem of making socialists again. If we're not doing that, creating socialists, people who are organizers, people who are thinking about alternatives to capitalism, I think the chances of even winning small are slim. We have to think bigger to win all our battles. If we think about this crisis, it immediately leads back to thinking about the last time there was a crisis like this, and that was the 30s. And in the 30s, workers were very creative in seeing the limits of craft unionism, skilled unions at that point in time, and moved. There was an explosion of industrial unionism, organizing workers across skills, organizing them across a whole sector to overcome competition, organizing them across race and gender. And the question is, at this moment in time, if this is the biggest crisis we've had since the 30s, what is going to emerge in the way of new working class organizations? And it's harder today, because the extent of the defeat of the left can't just mean we say, I'm talking about especially North America, the extent of the defeat, that, well, let's form a party. That has to come out of something. And that means thinking about the kind of intermediate organizations that can lay the base for that, and a base for recruitment. And in, you know, the kind of parties that are on the left today, like Der Linke, it raises all the kind of questions about, well, what do you really do? How do you bridge what unions are to something that they might be? I just want to say one final thing, because whenever I say this, it sounds like it's depressing and there's nothing to do. There are things to be done. We just don't have the capacity to do them. So let me just give the example of one of the points about the restructuring of production is that there are all kinds of production chains, and there's actually the possibility of shutting down some of them and affecting capital in a much deeper way. It actually had to do with why the Canadians were able to break away from the Americans, because we understood that, even though we're such a small part of the North American operation, if we could strategically shut down parts plants, we could affect all those American plants. So that's one kind of a question. There's the question of the restructuring away from manufacturing. Doesn't just mean that the good jobs are gone. The question is, why aren't other jobs good jobs? That's a social question. And the strategic question is that a lot of power now resides in things like warehouses, and the strikes of the Walmart workers are so important in that regard, and transportation systems, which can screw up the whole thing if you can organize and deal with it strategically. Okay, I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you, Leo and Sam, for giving us this broad picture about global capitalism, American empire, and the recent class struggles. Now the floor is open. Are there any questions or comments? Bitte.
Thank you very much for your two very interesting talks. I enjoyed it very much. Since I coincidentally got to know Sam Ginden through an interview he did with Doug Henwood of Behind the News, which he interviewed you on the Wisconsin developments. I just thought of a point he raised in one of his talks, saying that compared to what he calls the European austerity frenzy, which he doesn't get, he says, why is Germany pushing this austerity on the rest? And he says, compared to the Germany and the central bank and the European Central Bank, the Fed is almost getting rational and understanding that you need some amount of social, let's say, stability to be able to continue. So let's make that the starting question.
Are there other questions or comments? Yes, please.
I also really enjoyed both of the talks. I wanted just a slight little point, Sam, when you said that the effects on the working class of restructuring in the 80s, or beginning in the 80s, were to some extent also contingent. And I would just suggest that certainly, you know, the ruling class at no point knew exactly what was going to happen. But wouldn't you argue that there is also a very large amount of very conscious combating of unions, and that, you know, a lot of the restructuring in the 80s also targeted industries where the working class was particularly well organized and certainly also consciously sought to drain that? And I think if you look at the reaction of Walmart to these really almost pathetically small manifestations of resistance and how seriously they're taking it, it's very clear that the, you know, American businessmen know the danger of unions and don't want to go back to what I guess for them were the dark days of the 60s and 70s. And then just really briefly, I think that there's one thing that neither of you talked about, and I would be maybe interested in your comments in sort of the parts of the American empire. And I think one thing that's also very important to understand, that my impression at least, a lot of Europeans don't necessarily understand unless they're really interested in American politics, is the unique nature of the American state and the way, because, you know, for various contingent reasons over hundreds of years, you don't really have a unified federal or a unified national state, in that local and regional laws are so different that it's much easier for regional capitalists to change labor laws of, you know, entire states. Which allowed, you know, sort of like the right to work sort of initiatives to pass from state to state. And at the same time, so it allows much more flexibility and, you know, capitalists much more flexibility in taking regional influence, but also you essentially have an undemocratic electoral system and an entire culture of popular discussion that is essentially, you know, for lack of a better word, rigged. And to what extent that also plays a role in supporting or propping up the empire, and I guess most specifically how structurally closed the political system is, and if you think it's different than Europe and if it's an important factor.
Other questions? Yeah.
It's very nice to see you guys in Berlin. Hi. I guess there's three let's see if I can remember what the three are. There's three things. One thing, it seems to be a popular notion that with this crisis, the financialization of capitalism has hit a wall, and it's a crisis, and therefore it's something like happened previously, where finance is going to reduce its influence, and perhaps industry or something is coming to the fore. That does not seem to be what you guys are saying. Maybe if you could make some comments about that, because that's out there. Sam raises a very important narrative about historical sweep, which is important. People don't often talk in these terms over the sweep of craft unions in the first industrial revolution, the second industrial revolution with industrial unions and whatever this is, right? And I would just want to make a comment. Maybe you could comment on this. One important thing at each stage and what was organized and what was effective had to do with, insofar as people started without utopian ideas, but started with ideas of how does capital itself organize the working class, or create a class, and so forth. So even when Marx and Engels wrote, there was a lot of disagreements. What are you talking about, these guys? You know, they're not going to lead to anything. that sort of thing, and they recognized certain characters of the class, the working class, that was different from other oppressed classes that could get somewhere. And it's, if we start looking at how the information revolution has changed production, there are classes of people who move internationally, who think sort of the same way, come out in huge numbers at the same time before, like, the war in Iraq. Now, whether they're working class or something more like we would have called the skilled workers at one time, but there was nothing unprogressive about the skilled workers in the first stage and craft unions in a position to be a leading force. So there's lots of discussion that's gone on about this. But where is class consciousness actually arising from production itself and from the necessities of capitalist production, how it's organized. And then I think we start seeing some interesting things. It's not, however, sort of workers on the plant floor in that way. Although, if you look in the big factories now, you have this, it's becoming much more highly technical, and you have the mobility of work where people aren't, can be plugged into any industry and so forth. So even from the bottom. Anyway, that's the second point. And third, I hope this is not too much, along point Leo was making, you made a very important point that this has not led to more conflict amongst the great powers. There's some conflict with smaller powers that have to be taught how to play the game and join in. There is possibility of conflict with certain countries, China and its local neighborhood, and for local reasons, or Russia and so forth. However, so I would just say something, if you could comment on, there is a, well, the left got very much enamored with this idea of the rise of the BRICS and the multilateral, a multilateral world, sort of democratizing geopolitics. And I mean, I myself was sort of, didn't have a lot of confidence that that's exactly what was happening. It's, I mean, not that it's not a nice idea, but it wasn't actually what's developing. And you'll see that the whole idea has sort of dropped off the cliff now in the last year or so. The last time, I'm not saying there's not something, you know, to this, but the last time there was talk of some open opposition to Washington at a significant level was when China refused to support the sanctions on Iran in the beginning, and it looked like some other countries might join in. And there was a lot said about, this is the first time they openly said they wouldn't vote with the U.S. at the United Nations. Now, in fact, they're all on board. And it's a long story, but when you actually look into the details, from what I understand, it wasn't actually a matter of China threatening Obama do that. What it was is, look, if you guys shut down Iran, there goes 500,000 barrels a day for us. What are you going to do for us? We're not going to vote for you unless you take care of us. And Hillary Clinton went and jawboned, talked to the king, and the king talked to Qatar and UAE, and when their production rose 500,000 barrels, China voted for it. And that's quite a different way of looking at the pressure that China's putting on than here's China standing up as a new independent country. And it's just, anyway, those are three themes that are, fortunately, you guys touch on this quite a bit. It's quite very interesting, very, very useful.
Can I add one more, or would you like to answer immediately? You stressed very much the continuity of American empire, and I would like to ask if there aren't increasing contradictions. I mean, adding to this, when I look at the refinancing of the American state and the struggle about the Republicans and the Democratic Party, the increasing difficulties to refinance these huge deficits of the American state, isn't it reaching limits? And also, yes, the Chinese question, I mean, isn't it also more the weakness of, let's say, Europe, which makes appear the American state stronger today? So, or is it still so strong as it was in the past decades? Maybe you can also answer this question. What are the limits of American empire? I mean, every argument, or let's say every relation we have in global capitalism, you could argue somehow that there is a dimension of the American state and the strength of the American state related to it. But you can also turn it the other way around. You could also argue that Germany, for instance, plays a similar role at a smaller level in Europe, and that it depends all on the relations between the different capitalist classes and the different states. And with the internationalization of production, I see more in contradictions arising between American capital and the American state. So what will be the result of these processes?
I'll answer a couple of them and then turn it over to Leo rather than us trying to answer them all each. The question of that you raised about the contingency, no, I absolutely agree with you. I probably didn't make myself clear. I mean, when you look at what happened to the American working class, the state was very directly involved, not just in terms of letting unemployment rise, but they were involved in the negotiations around Chrysler. The head of the Federal Reserve, Volcker, sat on those negotiations, and one of the conditions for giving Chrysler money in the U.S. was that the workers take a $2 an hour cut, and that they outsource half their work. That was actually where a lot of the outsourcing strategies came from, the legitimation of the state. And then in the PATCO strike, I'm sorry, the air traffic controller strike in the United States, this is a very highly skilled workforce, and it seemed like, well, what can you do to them? And then when they went on strike, they jailed them. They broke them. And that was a message. That was a message to other business about what could be done. And part of that message was the limited response from labor, what you could actually get away with. So there, you know, and there was all kinds of strengthening administratively of making it harder to unionize. So anyway, you're absolutely right. I think the only point I was trying to make is that in addition to everything that was happening consciously, there is something that happens just through the logic of competition, and not just what any individual firm tries to do, that also ended up to restructure the working class in a way that weakened it. You know, this question of the working class and where the leading elements of the working class might come from and how that is changing. I just think it's a great question. I don't have any, you know, great insights about where that might come from. There's all kinds of questions of potential and whether those sections might be organized. But I do want to give a couple of examples. One is the public sector right now is at the forefront of the struggle, because this is what they're trying to break, the public sector unions. This is what they're trying to break so they can restructure the public services, but also so they can consolidate the defeat of the private sector unions. And the question is, can the public sector unions come up with new strategies that go beyond just bargaining for their members? And if they do, if they begin to think in terms of, we're not just going to say that public services are important, because everyone will see that cynically and opportunistic. We're going to show that we really mean it by putting public sector services on the bargaining table. We're going to make them a priority. And we may even put our own interests secondary. And if they did that, that begins to raise a lot of questions, because what they're starting to do is to use their organization to restructure the state, in a sense, and to begin discussing about the transformation of the state so it's democratized and there are links with clients and that they're servicing the clients, which raises a lot of interesting questions about what, you know, and that, you know, that raises all kinds of questions about how unions structure themselves, what they do with their resources, how they link up with the community, etc. So that might be interesting. And another example might be, you know, there have been opportunities to do things. We just haven't been able to do it. When the auto industry in the States, in the U.S., went through the crisis, the solution to it was, let's give subsidies to General Motors. In Germany, the solution to it was, let's sell more cars and share the work through work time. There was an alternative that could have been put on the agenda. The alternative could have been, we don't need more cars, that there are hundreds of plants being closed in the United States, that they should be converted, as Leo was raising. They should be converted to addressing all kinds of social concerns, especially the environment, in terms of infrastructure and changes in everything, basically, that we do at home, in factories, in the workplaces, in transportation, etc. And to put that on the agenda would have meant a different kind of unionism. It doesn't have the capacity to win that fight, but to begin a different kind of struggle, a struggle that says, we don't want to save General Motors, we want to save our productive capacity. We don't want to restore profits, we want to talk about social value. We don't want to say we want to be competitive so that so Ford workers will be laid off. We want to start talking about democratic planning. So I'm just saying that even within the amongst existing unions, because of their position in production, they could have played that role, and which they didn't. And then just a comment on what Thomas raised. It's an uneven process. I mean, the 70s were a very complicated process, and the question was, you know, was it going to fall apart? It was very significant that what happened through the 70s was that, unlike the 30s, was that globalization actually accelerates rather than breaks down. And that had to do with the way capitalism was integrated at the time. But it was a contingent process. It wasn't clear that they would come out of it. It's not clear how things, you know, will emerge in this period of time. And one of the important contradictions, which was raised earlier, and you raised as well, is that, as Leo's often mentioned, the American state is, you know, plays the role of a global state, but it's also the state of its own social formation. So these questions of what happens internally are crucial. And if the working class isn't a barrier right now, which I think is a potential contradiction if there was resistance, there are other forms of resistance through questions of Congress, questions of the right, questions of the Tea Party. So this question of what happens internally is important. I would really not want to say, and I know it sounds like this, because in a sense what we're looking at is history, and we're describing something that happened rather than projecting it. But I wouldn't want to argue that the American state is omnipotent, that I can just do this. You know, it has limits, there are contradictions. You know, the nature of crises is that you always have to come up with new institutional forms that don't exist. So it's a question of learning. Could the Fed come up with ways to prevent the financial crisis? We didn't know at the time. And in fact, did come up with ways that limited the financial crisis. Now can they come up with coping with this problem of austerity? And it's also complicated by the fact that this kind of empire works through states. That's one of the unique things about this empire. It's not a territorial empire, it works through states. And that's inherently complicated because it depends on the social relations within all those states, including the German state. So I think that all those kinds of questions are absolutely crucial. The one thing I did want to say about Wisconsin that I was trying to raise in that interview was that it was striking the extent to which the Fed was actually taking on this question of its responsibility for addressing the heart of the empire in terms of finance, but also of addressing the crisis in Europe in terms of a lot of its quantitative easing, was also seen as this money is going to flow into Europe. And so even though there's these historical and material bases for the development of state capacities, there's also a cultural element in terms of how the American state thinks. I mean, you know, other states aren't interested. They don't want the burden of empire. Germany has been very slow to take on that responsibility in Europe, which I think is very significant.
I didn't think you didn't mean to say that the Fed learned how to prevent the financial crisis. In fact, it did not learn to prevent the financial crisis. You meant it learned how to ensure that the banking system did not totally collapse. Yes? Where to begin? The Fed has been, above all, the U.S. Treasury, which is, as Volcker said to us when we interviewed him, always the pivotal agency inside the American state, has been very frustrated with the European Central Bank and therefore with the Bundesbank. And there's a long historical reason for this, because it is of its reluctance to act as lender of last resort. So even though you get a European Central Bank, which when it was created explicitly patterned itself on the Federal Reserve and drew on the 200 economists who work for it for much of its research capacity, et cetera, what was so frustrating to the US Treasury and Fed was the reluctance of the ECB to act as lender of last resort in this crisis. But beyond that, and this is what's so interesting, there was a frustration with the European states themselves. At a meeting in Washington, an ECB official who came to one of these meetings in Washington was greeted by an American host who, quote, and this is from the New York Times, brandished the Articles of Confederation, the 1971 precursor to the U.S. Constitution, and used it as an example of why stronger unions are necessary. He didn't mean Ginden's trade unions. He meant stronger federal unions are necessary, right? So I think the frustration lies with the fact that the European Union, for all of it being, as I said before, the most powerful international organization in the world in terms of its constitutional authority over its component members. What has come out in this crisis, and not nearly as much in the United States, is the independence of nation states within the European Union. So the point that someone was asking about, is there something unique in the United States in terms of the individual states being able to apply their own labor laws in a reactionary way? Yes, if you like, although they've often got a lead from the National Labor Relations Board or Republicans and even Democrats at a national level. But at, in terms of what the Fed and Treasury are able to do nationally, the European Union has not been able to do vis-a-vis the nation states. And that brings me to the question of, you know, is the United States too democratic in a way? And I think maybe the problem is that Germany is too democratic. That, I mean, apart from the culture of the Bundesbank, its Hayekian culture, its reluctance to encourage what they call moral hazard, there's also obviously a good deal of popular, I don't want to use the word racism, but attitudes within Germany that the state is responding to about lazy Greeks, yes? Undisciplined Southerners who haven't learned the Protestant ethic, yes? To some extent, the German state is clearly responding to that as well. Now, funny enough, in the American state, where there's a more vulgar and blatant racism, where there's a more vulgar populism, every time that there's a reaction to the American state playing this international role of taking responsibility for trying to contain capitalist crises, and there's loads of complaints often coming up in Congress, we will not vote for a bailout, etc. In every instance, the American administration overcomes those complaints and attempts to stop it in Congress. It may take a little while. It's like the question, you know, that came up the summer before last about raising the debt ceiling that Thomas asked. And here was a Republican majority in the House, almost a majority in the Senate. This Tea Party attitude, this know-nothing ignorance about whether the deficit, size of the deficit or the debt matter, when the rest of the world is dying to buy treasury bills at a rate of return that's lower than inflation, right? Because they're coming in for, as the safest haven, this is where you put your money, right? You can borrow all you want in the United States at very low interest rates, right? They could, in fact, be using it to engage in massive New Deal-type infrastructure building if they wanted to, right? And they'd be able to get it. So it's an insane thing to do with trying to shift the burden of taxation more onto the poor, to try to finally get rid of certain social services, etc. But in every instance, the American state is able to overcome that populism when it comes to lending money to foreign banks, right? When it comes to playing lender of last resort at a global level. The German state isn't. And that's interesting insofar as popular attitudes are a factor in the German state not bailing out the Greeks, right? I mean, I'd like to hear more from people here about why that is and what it represents, but it strikes me as significant. Tom's point, Tom O'Donnell's point about oil imperialism is, and we learned a lot from Tom in the course of writing this book, is very interesting here, I think. You see the extent to which the American state's involvement in Middle Eastern politics and indeed military conflicts has always been about not the protection of American oil companies primarily, not the securing of American energy needs primarily, but about ensuring that other capitalists who have energy shortages are able to get access to Middle East oil. Sure, knowing that they're dependent on the American state's role in getting that to them, right? And that becomes, sure, China's involved in renegotiating its place in global capitalism. And you just gave a very good example of the way in which the American role in the Middle East is used as a negotiating chip with China, right? Very interesting. Now, for the most part, however, and this relates to Thomas's point about continuity and discontinuity, I too am surprised by the continuity rather than the discontinuity. You know, what's so remarkable is that the little interest that China has taken, really, in the wars that have taken place in this decade. I mean, really, you go to China when invasions are taking place, and it's hardly in the press. Nobody talks about it. It's happening on the other side of the world, and they don't want to know about it. In that sense, there still is this Chinese isolation, in a sense. And although at certain moments they played a role on the Security Council, for obvious reasons, trying to limit America's claim to being the sole power who can invade every country in the world and get away with it. Nevertheless, they've really done nothing much more than issue that veto for all it's worth at the level of the Security Council. Right? And in that sense, militarily, the Americans really have had their way. Very largely. But I want us to make a deeper point. You would think that, you know, the G20 would cause more discontinuity. And there's certainly a lot of friction, I'm not denying that. But what you're seeing is how integrated Chinese late capitalist development is in global capitalism. Indeed, you know, the Americans and to some extent the Europeans were hoping that China would turn to more internally oriented development, that it would begin to be the consumer that Europe and the U.S. cannot be insofar as credit isn't as freely available to working class consumption. And that hasn't happened. And the Chinese communist elite that is turning itself so venally into a bourgeoisie is not about to shift very quickly from its export-oriented strategy. It's obvious. This is the late developer that is most dependent on trade in world history. This is the late developer that has most foreign direct investment that has come into it through its process of capitalist development. It's very hard for it, therefore, to develop a new strategy of growth that isn't dependent on further integration in global capitalism. And moreover, it knows very well that the management of that global capitalism is dependent on primarily the G7 finance ministries and central banks. So just to give you an example, when those shenanigans were going on in Congress and they were threatening not to allow the Americans to increase the debt ceiling, the Chinese said, "This is highly irresponsible of you. You're responsible for the global economy. You're responsible for managing the global reserve currency. You can't engage in these games." This is what the Chinese said to the Americans, right? And it was similar to what the Germans said to the Americans in the 1970s, when they were putting the most pressure on the Americans to control trade union militancy at home. We see this with the Brazilians today. Lula makes it impossible now to get a new round of trade agreements. Why does he make it impossible? What he's insisting is that Brazil agriculture become more integrated into North American and European agriculture. So the Landless People's Movement argues, we need a diversified agriculture in Brazil to feed our 200 million people. And the Lula government strategy, or now the PT government strategy after Lula, is to continue to try to integrate themselves as exporters into European and American agricultural markets. What they're struggling for is a renegotiation of position inside global capitalism of a kind that will integrate themselves further rather than disengage, rather than de-link. Similarly, and this really is quite tragic, the complaints that the Workers' Party finance minister has been making about American policy, which is using monetary policy, QE3, the easy provision of liquidity to the banks, which is explicitly designed to flow Wall Street bank money to European banks to prevent insolvency. What happened when the ECB decided to buy short-term European sovereign debt this September was directly linked to a new issue of quantitative easing in the United States. They were all very worried that American banks were stopping to lend overnight dollars to European banks over the summer. And as soon as that new round of quantitative easing happened, you got American money markets, mutual funds, again investing in European banks on short-term loans. So these have been integrated. The Brazilians say, if you keep doing QE3, this is going to have the effect of raising the Brazilian currency. Why are you so concerned, the Brazilian finance minister says, with the European crisis? Right? He comes to the IMF meeting and says, you're spending all of your time worrying about the European crisis. Right? You shouldn't be doing that. And so you see that the kinds of tensions that exist are about renegotiating positions, but they're not about, in any sense, breaking out of a global capitalism, unfortunately. I would expect there would be much more discontinuity than there has in fact been, and that was one of the things that I was trying to note. We'll have to see what happens, of course, and class struggles in any one of those countries could produce, you know, disjunctures in at the level of the state, at the level of class organization, which might yield something else. If the Chinese strikes begin to lead to an independent trade union movement in China that is not an agent of the Communist Party, an agency of managerial control, if those new independent unions start coalescing in a way that is oriented to resecuring collective services and collective needs rather than individual consumption, that could begin to provide an example for trade unionism more broadly, which would have an effect not only in China, but internationally and so on. But you know, these things are for the 21st century to reveal. We're not making predictions about how much this can stay together. All we would say is that if there's going to be a discontinuity, it now appears that it'll involve a massive change in class and state structure, not only in Europe, which is obviously the case, might happen in Greece, but that's what it would take, but increasingly it would involve a massive change in class and state structure, even in the big capitalist countries of the global south. That's what it's looking like to us, at any rate.
This is partly repeating what Leo said, but I think it's so important. I want to emphasize it. When you ask the question of, is America stronger, I think that has to be answered qualitatively rather than looking at numbers. So, if you're comparing 1950, when it looked like who can challenge America, versus today, in 1950, a third of the global population was outside of capitalism in terms of Eastern Europe and China. Now they're integrated. If you're comparing it to the 70s, in the early 70s, there were still nationalist movements and liberation movements that were talking about getting out. What is so striking is how absent that is. And the third element of this is we're in this great financial crisis after a quarter century of neoliberalism and attacks on the working class, when not just finance, but capital should have been delegitimated so much during this crisis, we see the working class still on the defensive, and therefore not as a barrier to the continued restructuring. I'm talking about this especially in the United States. So, you know, in all those ways, you could say that they're stronger. But I would certainly completely agree with, you know, the kind of qualifications you're talking about. That's kind of measuring it up to where we are today. Okay?
Okay. I've seen another hand. Michael? Yeah. This doesn't work anymore.
I mean, you were, I'm trying to speak it out. You were asking about this question about why Germans have this, these virtues, these Protestant ethics, and like to work hard. And I think this is very deeply enshrined in German broad culture, some way. And there was a proposition by the German, by the European Parliament that countries in Europe which have an export surplus should also be punished. Yeah? Countries that have export surpluses, because this harms other countries, should be punished. It came from the European Parliament. And this was, well, when it was accepted by the German public at all, which it was not really to a large extent, it was an outcry of, this is absurd, this is totally nonsense. This is, how can you punish people which have worked so hard, which are competitive, which try to, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I think, perhaps, I mean, if you, I don't know how deeply you can go, but Germans usually are not very proud of Germany as a country. They're not very nationalist. Yeah. You don't see German flags, you don't see Germans. I mean, this is German history. But I think the only thing which they are proud of internationally, comparing themselves with other countries, is this. We are working hard. We are export, world masters in export. Yeah? Or this thing. And this brings me to another thing which you said, because this is, has a long tradition, and if Germans could re-elect any of their former chancellors, I think it would be Helmut Schmidt, which they would like to re-elect. And he also represents this, and especially with the conflict with the United States in the crisis in the 70s, with the Carter administration, who went for expansion, Keynesianism, and Helmut Schmidt went for austerity. Yeah. And you said, which I didn't understand, that when the Germans, they pressured American administration to discipline trade unions, etc., etc. I think this was irresponsible in some way. And what the Chinese are now asking the Americans to do, it's not irresponsible. There's something so that is different. Because I think you made a comparison between, I mean, this Helmut Schmidt thing, which really means that all countries have to do austerity policy, and they will all solve their problems. Everyone has to look at their own country, yeah, and has to become like us, and then problems will be solved. This is the very simple thinking behind it, and I think it's totally irresponsible.
In both cases, and the Brazilians are saying to the Americans, you need to be above all mindful to keep the value of the dollar, to stabilize the value of the dollar as the global currency. And insofar as they're saying that, what they're saying is that the Fed needs to be careful, yes? Or the US Treasury needs to be careful not to do such things that might weaken the dollar. Now, if weakening the dollar is throwing so much liquidity into the banking system, into credit, as to create worries about, as the Germans are worried about, will this lead to inflation if we have too loose a monetary policy? The result of that in the United States, the Brazilians effectively are saying, is that you should let unemployment go higher still. Because if the Fed didn't have as loose a monetary policy, you would have unemployment well over 10% in the United States. And what the Germans were saying in the 1970s, in the late 1970s especially, was we are being or disciplined with our unions, or we're getting cooperation and wage restraint from our unions, and you're not getting it. You've got too militant a working class, which is making inflationary wage demands, and you need to break them. I mean, that was the direct message that Schmidt was giving to Volcker before they introduced the Volcker shock and raised interest rates to 18%, deliberately to raise unemployment. So, but I wanted to raise a point, though, about the cultural explanation. I mean, it is very significant that this is essentially a mercantilist policy. that we will export ourselves to wealth, which the whole world rationally cannot do. And you see the fundamental difference that the American empire has in the world. It has very large exports, as Sam was saying, but that deficits are not a problem for it. Not everyone who's a policymaker in the United States understands that. But it is a distinction that is enormously important in terms of the Americans managing a world in which they run a trade deficit, while the other most successful countries are those who run a trade surplus in capitalism. And that has to do with the flow of capital into the American dollar, the flow of capital into the United States, which makes it possible to run this trade deficit. But it also has to do with the restructuring that Sam spoke of, so that you get multinational corporations who, like Apple, who every time an Apple is sold and 50% of the value of it comes to American capital, it looks like an increase in the American trade deficit because it's assembled outside the United States. So it looks like an increase in the deficit because of where the assembly is done, where the final product comes from back into the United States, but 50% of the profit goes to Apple, even though this is an element in the American trade deficit. I just wanted to raise the cultural question, though, and it's a problem for socialists to stop at how deep this is in our culture. I was told by a Chinese Marxist recently when I asked about the strike waves in China, this is a Marxist professor of Marxism-Leninism who has taught men on the Central Committee. And he said, oh, it's nothing to worry about. For thousands of years, because of Chinese Confucianism, we always have a culture of class harmony, not class conflict. This is a professor of Marxism-Leninism saying this. Yeah. And I'm not saying that there isn't something to it. But obviously, cultures change. And they were changed by the Chinese Communist Party when engaged in enormous conflict itself to transform China. So, one of the questions one needs to ask about human agency and about the German labor movement and maybe even about Die Linke is what is being done to challenge that culture? What is being done to turn the German labor movement from treating its own goal as that of competitiveness? Not treating competition as a constraint, but treating competition as the goal. And I think part of the culture you're describing is exactly that. Whereas historically, the German labor movement was built on a notion of solidarity rather than competitiveness. And what kind of struggles are going on here around those two different cultural values? Discipline for the end of competitiveness, as opposed, if you like, for discipline to the end of solidarity, and a notion of solidarity that might include, obviously, other European workers rather than just German workers, to raise a very old question about the German labor movement's internationalism or not.
Well, yeah, Raoul.
I find it really convincing what you told us today, but I would have a question about the resource conflicts. I think you haven't spoken too much about this. Michael Klare and other researchers insist a lot on this issue, and I find it really convincing too that these planetary boundaries and the limitation of nature will have a great or an important effect on the competitiveness among capitalist states, question this kind of transnational you don't call it like this, but this empire which is more interested in an international trade and capital flow than in state logics. So this would be one point. The other point if I understood you right, you said that the control of capital flows and of the finance system is a strategic point for kind of counterpower, and I'm not really sure if I got the point, but I think that national sovereignty is at least at the moment the only strategy to execute a kind of control over capital flows, and this is in a way a contradiction to what we are also discussing here against national strategies, and it's really really strange to discuss this from a German point, but in Latin America I find it, and I was really surprised by it, that in Latin America in the last decade the return of discourses and practices of national sovereignty opened new possibilities of social and democratic policies. So these were the two points.
I'm sure that we're all getting exhausted, but I entirely agree with you. And I think that there are possibilities here because of the nature of this empire. It's an empire without colonies, in which the American Federal Reserve can't tell the Bundesbank what to do. It can't even tell the Canadian Bank of Canada exactly what to do. So there's a degree of relative autonomy for nation states within this empire. And that opens up possibilities. I think, I entirely agree, that we need to use that relative autonomy, and it requires a shift in the balance of forces within each nation state. We have to use that relative autonomy to reintroduce capital controls. And most important in that respect is not just the flows of capital inside and outside the country, but the control of investment, in that sense, capital controls inside the country, right? And to understand that way. And I agree that's the key contradiction in the nature of this empire. Now, that then raises the question, however, of international solidarity. If one country does that, in what way do we try to build the kind of solidarity across nation states that support one another that do that? So one of the questions that did come up in Bretton Woods and was immediately forgotten was, could you have a system of capital controls of a kind that requires that when capital flows somewhere else, that the place it goes to, if they belong to an international organization together, they are obliged to apply the domestic capital controls of the country where it's coming from. So if there was a shift in the balance of forces in Germany, we know very well that a great part of the Greek problem has been the flow of capital out of Greece by Greeks. Yes. And if you had rules in the European Union that meant that you, if there were domestic capital controls in Greece, it would be an obligation on the part of nation states elsewhere in the European Union to apply the Greek capital controls, not allow them to move to Frankfurt. That's how you start thinking about transnational solidarity. Of course, that means you have to have sympathetic governments in power to precisely do that. But I do think we need to, it's dangerous because we're playing perhaps with nationalism, with a populist nationalism, and I understand why Europeans especially are reluctant to play that game. On the other hand, it's hard to see our way forward if we don't use the strategic opportunities available in democratic forms within nation states to increase national sovereignty to the end of socialist transition, which is what they're talking about in those places in Latin America. The danger is that there'll be forces on the right which will also use economic nationalism, of course. I think what we have going for us now is that there aren't national bourgeoisies to support fascist economic nationalist forces of the kind that did exist in the 1930s. German capital is too heavily invested internationally to likely support that. And to pick up the resource question, I think German capital is too dependent on the role that the American military plays around the world in guaranteeing energy sources for Europe to want to play that role. Now, who knows what's going to happen later in the 21st century. For the moment, it's actually United States ships which keep the water routes open for China to get the oil that it needs and some of the other resources that it needs. But I don't deny there may be massive resource conflicts. And to the moment, the American state's role still remains that it will engage in military conflict to the end of ensuring that global capitalism as a whole is fueled by resources. But will it always do so? Who knows? I mean, this is history's contingency. And I certainly don't want to be predicting that that could not happen.
Thank you. Thank you, Leo and Sam, and thank you all for listening and discussing.